Now, if you're new to the game of disc golf, you might be wondering, well, where do I start? With all these discs available to me, how do I know which is the right one for me? And I'm going to answer that question for you. Now, when you're starting out, there's only two types of discs that you want to pay attention to. That would be a putter and a mid-range. Now, there's a couple reasons for that. First is these are the two most important discs in your bag, regardless of your skill level. The second is these are going to be the easiest discs for you to control. Now, we'll start with the putter. Putters are the most important disc in disc golf, by far. You need to sink your putts to be able to score well. Now, putters are going to be a very individual thing, and some people, they might putt with one type of disc, and then use a different type of putter for upshots and short drives. There's nothing wrong with that. Some people even use three or four molds, and that's okay. The only thing that I recommend is for all of your putts, you want to use the exact same disc every single time, and you probably even want to use the exact same disc whether it's from the same mold as other discs in your bag or not. For example, I carry three Ions in my bag most days, but I always putt with the same one Ion. Now, putters are useful for much more than just throwing putts. They're the most accurate upshot disc you can throw, and the reason for that is they're very slow and easy to get up to speed so that you can make them glide very easily without having to throw them with much power. Now, I use Ion putters. I think they're very good, especially for a driving putter, because they have a more dense material on the outside of the rim than on the inside, and that lets them be more gyroscopic and fly further. However, there are very many putter molds out there that are very good. You don't have to use this just because I do. You don't have to use the same disc that your friend uses, the same one that King Climo uses. You can use whichever one feels comfortable to your hand, as long as you can control it, put it on a straight line easily, and it holds up to a little bit of wind. Some other popular putter molds are the Discraft Challenger and the Magnet, the Innova Aviar, and the Gateway Wizard. Now, any of these should be perfectly fine for someone to learn with. This is just my personal preference. Now, one of the biggest mistakes I see disc golfers make is they don't drive with their putter. And that might sound like a weird idea to you, driving with a putter, because isn't that what you putt with? No, that's not the only thing it's used for. You can use it for short upshots of great accuracy. You can also use it off the tee pad for your drive. One of my favorite things to do to practice driving putters to go to a short course, like a local 9-hole that has, say, 200 to 300 foot holes for the most part, and just throw nothing but putters. Just bring a bag with two or three driving putters, and then the one that you like to putt with, just play a putter round. You can see I've got a couple videos in my collection of me throwing putter rounds at different courses, and I posted those to give you an idea of just what a putter is capable of. A lot of people underestimate what they can do driving a putter, and if you practice it, you'll find that it'll come very easily to you. One thing to keep in mind, though, is you want to avoid throwing overstable putters and mid-ranges if you're trying to work on your form, such as the zone, the drone, or the vector even, because what you want to do is you want to have something that's going to respond to how you're throwing it, that's going to give you feedback. You don't want to throw something that's going to mask your mistakes. Now, this is true whether you're throwing backhand or whether you're throwing forehand. A lot of people out there will tell you that you need something overstable for a forehand throw, and that's not true. When you're throwing forehand, things are not much different than when you're throwing backhand. The form is a little bit different, but a lot of the same concepts apply, and you can use the same disc interchangeably for backhand and for forehand. And another thing you'll see in my video collection is some forehand-only putter rounds, and that just goes to show you that a disc that most players won't even think about throwing forehand, you can even drive with it. Now, the next disc you want to buy yourself after a putter is a mid-range. You can see it's still a pretty blunt edge, but it's a little bit more aerodynamic than most putters are. And these will fly a little bit further. They'll fight the wind a little bit better because the wind won't be pushing against the side of the disc quite as much as a putter. So these are the logical next step. Now, some of the popular mid-range molds that I'd recommend starting out with would be the MVP Axis. You could use a Discraft Comet, or you could try an Innova Shark, or an Innova Rock. And you want to pick something that's not too overstable, like a drone or a gator. And you also don't want to pick something that's pretty fast for a mid-range, like a Discraft Impact. And what you'll be using the mid-range for is it can be used for a lot of short drives, and they're very useful for upshots. This is the type of disc that most players throw an upshot with. I typically use a putter for my upshots, but if there's some low-hanging branches and I need to get under them, then a mid-range will work better for that. And if there's a strong headwind coming in, I'll also use a mid-range because, like I said, they fight wind a little bit better. And just like putters, mid-ranges, they can be thrown backhand, they can be thrown forehand. There's absolutely nothing stopping you from throwing a mid-range off the tee pad with a forehand or a backhand throw. Once you've developed clean form, you should be able to forehand or backhand a mid-range well over 300 feet. Now, there's a wide-open hole at my home course that's about 380 feet long. I'll throw a mid-range on that hole usually if the wind is calm, because I can get a mid-range out that far pretty comfortably. So that's just to illustrate that even if you can throw a high-speed driver 500 feet, mid-ranges will still play a very vital role in your game. However far you're comfortable throwing them, you should use them off the tee pad on holes that short, because they can offer you a very accurate shot, very minimal fade, and very minimal skip, but they'll go a little bit further than a putter and fight wind a little bit better, so they're a very good compromise between control and predictability. The next step we have is a driver. Now, this is a very low-speed driver compared to some of the more modern ones, but this is what you want to pick after you've developed some fundamentals and you've thrown your putters and your mid-ranges around a bit. I'd recommend getting your first driver once you can throw your mid-range at least 200 feet or so. And you want to start out with something with a very narrow rim, like this disc has. Now, this is a Millennium JLS. Now, some other popular fairway drivers are the Innova Leopard and the Innova T-Bird, as well as the Discraft Cyclone. Now, the reason why I recommend this over one of the higher speed drivers once you're starting out is these are easier to get up to speed. You can throw the JLS probably 300 feet or so, and it'll fly pretty accurately and pretty true to its flight ratings for you. Now, if you try and throw, say, an Innova Boss 300 feet, it's going to fly a lot more overstable than it's supposed to for you, and it's going to be a lot harder to utilize a disc. What a lot of players do when they're starting out is they'll get a disc that's too fast for them, and they'll try and throw it on an Anheuser, whether they're throwing backhand or forehand, so that way when the disc starts slowing down and it fades out, they can stretch out a little more distance with it. And that's not what you want to do. That's not how you're going to develop good form. You want to pick a disc that matches your skill level and how far and how fast you're throwing. And you want to practice a nice, smooth, flat release and develop control and consistency. And what you'll probably be using your fairway drivers for is shorter drives that you might be able to reach with a mid-range, but it'd be pushing it, or drives that a little bit lower of a ceiling than you're comfortable throwing a mid-range under. They can be very good for rollers because the narrow rim lets them roll a little bit better than mid-ranges. One of the main advantages of a fairway driver over a high-speed driver is when it does fade, it doesn't crash to the ground quite so drastically, and it doesn't drift offline to the left or right, depending on how you're throwing it, quite as much as a high-speed driver does. When a low-speed driver fades, it's a lot more gradual, and it'll just gently drift to the ground, and it'll still glide forward and glide out more than a high-speed driver does. So, as a beginner, when you're only throwing, say, 200 to 300 feet, this is the driver you want to use, something with a narrow rim like this. Now, once you've advanced your game a little and you have a solid grasp of all the fundamentals, the next step you can do is pick a higher speed driver like this. You can see this is a much more aerodynamic design than the last driver. This is called a Millennium OLF, or Orion Long Fade. Some similar discs include the Innova Starfire, the Discmania PD, and the Discraft Avenger. Now, the advantage of these discs are they go much further and they can fly a lower line than discs like the T-Bird or the Leopard. They'll fight wind better because they'll slice through it more. The wind has less surface area to push against. And they'll still be relatively easy to control as long as you can get them up to speed. I'd say once you hit about 325 feet with a JLS, a Leopard, or T-Bird, that's about when you could start messing around with something in this speed range. Now, compared to the highest speed drivers like the Speed 13 Bosses and the Nukes and stuff like that, these drivers will be much easier to control and they'll fade out much less. So they'll be easier to keep on the line that you need and they'll be much easier to control. Now, I find these kind of discs are the workhorse drivers on my bag because they fly lower lines, so it kind of separates them from the mid-ranges a little bit better than the slower drivers. They resist wind a little bit better, and they get me very good distance. My longest throws with this particular disc right here have been about 450 to 470 feet long, and on an average day, I can count on being able to throw it in the 420 to 440 foot range. And now that'll depend on what the hole is like. If it's downhill, I can throw it further. If it's uphill, probably not as far. And if there's wind in play, I probably won't try and push it out to my maximum distance. Now, the very last disc you want to buy yourself, and this is only once you're a very advanced player, are the high-speed drivers. Now again, like I said, one mistake a lot of newer players make is they'll start out with something like this because they see how aerodynamic it is, they see that it's rated speed 13, and they think, oh, well, it's the highest speed rating, obviously it has to go the furthest. And yes, that's true if you can get it up to speed, but it's not true if you can't get it up to speed. And what you'll see a lot of players do to compensate for their lack of arm speed is they'll throw a forehand that looks like that so that the disc rides out on an anhyzer, straightens out, and fades back. And if you have to do that to get distance with a disc, it's probably too fast for you. Now, some other popular high-speed drivers are the Innova Katana and Boss and Destroyer, the Discraft Nuke, Nuke OS, and Nuke SS, and this, the Millennium Quasar. What you don't want to do, you don't want to purchase a high-speed disc like this until you can throw about 400 feet, in my opinion. And some people might tell you you only need to throw 300, 350 feet to utilize them, but my opinion, to get a disc of this fast up to speed, you need to be throwing the slower drivers at least 400 feet. Personally, I stuck with my Millennium OLFs until I could throw them at least 430 feet, and that's when I felt comfortable throwing a disc like this. Now everyone, they have their own goals and their own preferences, but again, what I recommend is be able to throw forehand or backhand at least 350 to 400 feet, and then start experimenting with high-speed drivers. But if you do it too early, you're probably going to wreck your form, and it's not going to be good for you in the long term. You want to start out throwing putters in mid-ranges of neutral stability, and once you have a handle on the fundamentals and can get those at least 200 feet out, you can start trying to throw something like an Innova Leopard or a T-Bird. Work with those until you hit about 300, 325 feet. You can experiment with the speed 8, speed 10, speed 9 range, stuff like the Innova Valkyrie, the Millennium OLF, or the Discmania PD. Now once you can get those out to about 375, 400 feet, then you can start trying out things like the Destroyer, the Boss, the Quasar, and high-speed discs like that. But don't start out too fast too soon. That's probably the most common mistake in disc golf, and it's one that I'm guilty of just as well as pretty much every other player out there. And what I had to do because of that is I developed a very off-axis torque-based throw to get those discs out further because I didn't have the proper form to throw them correctly. And then I had to go back and I had to rework parts of my throw, and that ended up causing me a lot more time in the long run than if I would have just followed the advice I'm giving you today. So don't make the same mistake as me and nearly every other player out there. Start with slow, easy to control disc, and then work your way up gradually as you feel comfortable. So what I recommend is start out with the lower end plastics, the cheaper ones, and there's a couple reasons for that. The first is they inherently glide better. The other is they'll start to wear in more quickly, and so you can get an idea of how a disc ages over time. With a higher end disc like a Champion Leopard, it might take you 2 years to see what it looks like for that disc to wear in. And another advantage is if you buy a disc and you decide you don't like it, you're only out $6 to $10 as opposed to $15 to $20. So it's a lot more economical when you're beginning and you aren't sure what you like to throw and what you don't.